Okay, I can't resist saying it. Can you hear me now? I love it. All right. Good morning, everyone. What a beautiful looking crowd. We are here to celebrate Palm Sunday and everything that that implies about the Lord Jesus entering Jerusalem. I'm going to be talking about that in the message, but we are so thrilled to see everybody. Guests, we want you to know we love you. We are so thrilled to have you. We hope you'll come and join us again. And if you don't mind, if you're a guest today, if you fill out one of those things and put it in the offering plate as you come by and let us get some information, I promise not to show up at your house at mealtime, but we'll at least call you or send you an email or text and say thank you for attending Southside Baptist. Well, we're going to have a great service. Let's pray together and begin our worship. Father, this morning we are so grateful to be in your house, Lord. We thank you so much, Father, for the wonderful service we're about to have. Lord, we just ask that you take control of this service, Lord. Father, we are here to worship you and you alone. Father, we give you all the glory, all the praise. Lord, we are here because we need you. We need your presence. We need each other. Father, we are so thankful for Jesus Christ, especially on Palm Sunday, what it means to us, Father, and to our families. Lord, this morning, as this service progresses, Lord, we pray that all of our hearts will be touched, that we'll let go of the problems we're facing in our lives and come to your throne and worship you. And Father, hear from you, whatever you have for us, Lord. Have your will in your way. And Father, we thank you that we can praise the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his holy name we pray. Amen.
One of the strongest symbols of Jesus in the Bible is that of Lamb. And we are going to sing of the Behold the Lamb. The choir has sung this on several occasions, but as far as I remember, we've never sung it as a congregational song. So we have our largest choir ever, you, the band, and our normal choir, singing together, Behold the Lamb. So let's stand to sing. Time, let's greet one another in the name of the Lord. Yeah. Thank you. You may be seated. If you didn't get to somebody at this moment, try to greet them at the end of the service. You may be seated. We have a scripture reading now that puts us into the situation of the triumphal entry of Jesus, which is what we celebrate on Palm Sunday. There'll be readings, a major reading by Brother Tim. The adult choir will also read. The children will read. At the very end, you're all invited to read the scripture that'll be on the screen.
When they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus then sent two disciples, telling them, "Go into the village ahead of you. At once you will find a donkey tied there, and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you should say that the Lord needs them, and immediately he will send them." This took place so that what was spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. The disciples went and did just as Jesus directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt. Then they laid their robes on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their robes on the road. Others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them on the road. Then the crowds who went ahead of him and those who followed kept shouting, "When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken, saying, 'Who is this?' And the crowds kept saying, 'This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee.'"
choir presented this same piece a couple of weeks ago, and we were a little reduced in number, but it came off. We have a few more this Sunday, and I appreciate our choir both this Sunday and next Sunday, where we'll be doing some additional Easter music next Sunday. I want to say, too, next Sunday, in this auditorium at a quarter till, there's going to be some youth singing and children singing. So if you're involved in that or want to hear that, you might need to get out of Sunday school a little bit early and come on down to the auditorium at 10:45.
The blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood that Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory.
we return to our enormous choir, all of us here singing When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, band, choir, and you as choir. This is a familiar hymn, but there are a lot of little surprises in it. I think you'll make the transitions normally. We are following what is in the hymnal, so if you want to look at that, it's 234. And I don't know that I got the ushers noted when to come down, but come down on the last stanza. Okay. So we're going to stand and sing. Probably one of the greatest hymns about the cross is When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you for coming into your house today, God, and just praising you and worshiping you in song and in spirit and music, Father. Father, we just continue to bless this service, Father, as we go forward. Father, right now, we just ask you to bless these tithes and offerings into your kingdom, Father, and just give us the wisdom as a church to use them to glorify your kingdom and your son. And Father, just continue for the ones that are not here today, God, that you know the reason. The sick or the shut in, Father, just be with them and heal them, because you are the great physician, Father. Father, we just want to lift up all of this in your name. Amen.
We haven't actually really saved the best for the last, but it will be good, just as what has come already will be good. We're inviting the Gill family to come up and sing for us at this time.
Walker and I are going to share a song with you this morning. The title of it is New Again. And sometimes when we think about the sacrifice that Jesus made, we may not think about that somebody had to give him up. He was giving up his life, but you think about what God was giving up. He was giving up his only begotten son for rotten sinners like us, but he did it willingly. And I'm so thankful for Jesus' blood on my life this morning. I can't imagine waking up a single day in my life without Jesus.
Supposed to be. I'm right here. Can you hear my voice? My life, my love, my Lord, my baby boy. As they nail me to this tree, just know the be your will to have your son and my son killed. Whatever happens, whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you has become of me, this is not. It's not the end, 'cause I am making all things new again.
I remember when you were born in that manger where I first held you in my changed, and this world repays you how with all this pain.
As they nail me to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be? To have your son and my son killed.
Whatever happens, whatever you see,
I don't want to see.
Whatever your eyes tell you has become of me, it's not.
Tell me it's not.
It's not the end. Whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you.
Can anybody say amen to that? That was awesome. Thank you, all the musicians and everybody. Bless you so much. What a wonderful service God has blessed us with. Okay, if you have your Bibles, we're going to be in the book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 12. John chapter 12, beginning with verse 12. John 12, 12 is where we're going to be starting a little bit. Before we begin, though, I'm going to ask Kayla Strickland if she would come and stand by me. Somebody slipped me a note this morning, Kayla. Everybody look at this beautiful young lady. Kayla Strickland was selected Junior Miss Nahanna Elementary School Friday night. Can we give her a hand? Okay, every beauty queen gets to make a speech. What do you want to say? Nothing, okay. We are so proud of you. Congratulations, honey. She already told me, I told her before the service I didn't want to scare her. I said, I'm going to get you up here. And she said right before the service, I'm mad at you, Brother Jerry. I said, please forgive me, but we wanted to recognize you. We're so proud of you. And I know Faith sitting right next to her had it last year, right? Weren't you? She's the beauty queen. So, hey, boys, let me tell you, if you want the most beautiful girls in town and the godliest girls in town, come to church, right? Just word to the wise here. All right, before we read the scripture, I want to show you a few slides, and I need some help coming up with some captions. These have to do with the sermon. Okay, we're going to talk about something very important. Let me show you some slides of some unusual friends. What would the caption to that be? Look, Ma, no hands? How about that? Okay, how about the next slide? That is a dog and an owl laying on the couch together. Like, who is that with you? I'm sorry, I'll move on. Okay, next slide. Which one of you is the bird brain? I don't know the caption. Okay, now, can everybody see what that was? I'm going to show you a better one. What is this? A donkey with, you know what? Let me show you another one. One more slide. What does it mean when you see a lamb ride a donkey into town? That's the title of our message this morning. What does it mean when I see a lamb riding a donkey into town? Of course, we're talking about Jesus coming in. Today is Palm Sunday. This is the day we celebrate when Jesus rode into Jerusalem the last week of his life here on the earth. Before he was crucified, this is that we call it the Holy Week, the week of Passion. What he went through for each and every one of us, we're going to talk about this morning. Now, Jesus was well known throughout the nation, but he had been up in the northern part for most of his ministry. He'd been up in 60, 70 miles away from Jerusalem, up around the Sea of Galilee, Capernaum, walking around the lake, headed to Nazareth, crossing back and forth across the Sea of Galilee. If you've read any of the Bible, you know that he was always up in that area. Once in a while, he'd come down south. But just a couple of days before this, or just that week before, he was in Bethany, and he raised Lazarus from the dead. And man, the news went like wildfire. Jesus is near Jerusalem. And now, of course, all the enemies of Jesus, they know he's near. and the Passover feast is happening. We're going to talk about what Passover was. But look, so now this sets it up. Look at verse 12 at our first scripture here in John chapter 12, verse 12. It says, the next day, a great multitude that had come to the feast. They're talking about the Passover feast. When they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took branches of palm trees and they went out to meet him and they cried out, Hosanna. When you see that word Hosanna, it means save us, help us. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Then Jesus, when he'd found a young donkey, he sat on it as it is written, Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. His disciples did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, in other words, after he rose from the dead later, then they remembered these things written about him and that they had done these things to him. Wow, what an incredible passage of Scripture. Let's pray together. Father, we love you this morning. We thank you for that we can celebrate today, Palm Sunday, the day a lamb rode a donkey into Jerusalem. The Savior of the world, the Son of God, came to stand for all of us. Father, this morning, speak to our hearts as only you can. Have your will and your way in this service. Help us all to realize what you did, and you did it for us. You did it because you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, now let me just do a couple of things here. The feast was Passover. Let me explain Passover. If you don't understand what Passover is, we heard that term. If you've ever been in church much, you hear that term. The Passover feast is something the Jews have been celebrating for thousands of years. They're still celebrating. And in fact, I looked it up on the internet. If you were to go to Israel and wanted to celebrate Passover this year, it's Friday night, April the 22nd, to sundown, Saturday night, April the 23rd. They are still celebrating the Passover feast. In their day, they'd already been celebrating. When Jesus rode into town that day on that donkey, they'd been celebrating Passover for hundreds of years. What Passover is when God sent Moses to get them out of Egypt. He told them that very last night, he said, I'm coming to get y'all. And it's not going to be pretty. This, I'm paraphrasing here. He said, I want each of your families to gather a young baby lamb without blemish. I want you to sacrifice this lamb, and I want you to put the blood of this lamb on your door, your front door of your house. When I come to wreak judgment on the Egyptians, when I see the blood of this little lamb, I'm going to pass over your house. That's what Passover is. And God told them, I want y'all to celebrate this, remember this, every year after I brought you out of Egypt. So that's what they were doing. God gives them instructions. By the way, if you want to read that, you can go to Exodus chapter 12 sometime and read all about Passover. Okay, now how big was Passover in Jesus' day? We don't exactly know, but let me tell you how big it was just a few decades later. Somebody wrote down the last year they did it was 70 A.D. That was right before the Romans destroyed Jerusalem, so maybe 60, 70 years after Jesus was crucified. Anyway, or 30, 40 years after Jesus was crucified. That year, 70 A.D., somebody wrote this down. They had 270,000 lambs sacrificed at Passover. So this is a major, this is the big Jewish festival, Jewish feast. Now let me tell you, three things this morning. What does it mean to me when I see, and to you, when we see a lamb ride a donkey into town? When Jesus rides into Jerusalem, what does it mean? Number one, I love this part. Brother Frank's going to put it up on the screen. Number one, it means God is adding the final and most important part of his worldwide salvation offer. In other words, anybody ever cook something and you're cooking along and you keep tasting it? You done that and you think, that needs a little salt. You put a little salt in and you keep tasting it until you get it just right. Anybody ever done that? Most of my food, I don't get that far. I throw it out before I actually ever taste it. But God is saying, he's saying, listen, this is it. I've been what we call doing progressive revelation. You know, God showed a little bit of himself to Abraham. He brought Abraham into the promised land, said, I'm going to give you this land. God showed a little more of himself to Moses. God showed a little more of himself to the Jewish people. They started the sacrifices and the keeping the laws and everything. Passover is when God puts the final piece of the puzzle into place. Jesus is the fulfillment of everything God has to give human beings. He is the complete plan of redemption. Now, you know, it's funny. Once you have something complete, do you mess with it anymore? When the meal is good, what do? I mean, the food tastes right. What do you do? Okay, y'all, this is not hard. What do when you eat it, right? Jesus was God's perfect sacrifice, his perfect plan riding into town for each and every one of us. Jesus Christ was thinking about you. He was thinking about me when he rode into town. He was there because he was the missing piece to God's perfect plan. And I love the way he did it. He didn't come into town. Now, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, what usually happens when a conquering army came into town in those days? If they were conquering somebody, what would they do? They'd destroy everything. They'd have a big parade coming in. The generals would be in the front. You know, if you've ever seen pictures of the Roman army marching into town, they had all kind of fanfare, trumpet blowing, and all the kind of stuff. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords rides into town on a donkey colt. What does that mean? Why would Jesus Christ, the Lord of Lords and King of Kings, pick a little lowly donkey colt and ride into town? That says what his heart is like. He says, I come to serve. I come in peace. The Son of God says, I'm not here to rule over you. I came to serve you and to love you. Isn't that great? Anybody ever treat you like that? Hey, you ever go to a restaurant and the waiter or waitress is rude? You ever have that? Does that take away from some of the enjoyment of your meal? Of course it does. You know, you're thinking they come and throw your food down there, or your tea's empty, and you're like, this? Look how Jesus came to town. He came into town as a servant. That's what he wants us all to be. He wants us to learn how to serve him and serve other people. And he came into town publicly. Hey, he didn't sneak around and hide and slip through the back door. He knew what was going to happen to him, and he still walked into town, rode into town publicly. That says, I love you that much. I'm putting myself in grave jeopardy, grave danger, because I love you. That's the definition of love. You know, teenage girls, I want to tell you something. If a guy wants to court you, date you, and he won't come and stand in front of your mom and daddy, dump him. Right? I want a young man to come and stand, if I had a daughter, stand in front of me and say, sir, I'd like to take your daughter out this evening. Would that be okay? Don't you guys? Don't you want that? But if he's sneaking around the back door, hey, let's meet up. You go to your friend's house, and I go to my friend's house, and we'll meet up. Dump him. He needs to be a man. True love stands up and shows itself and is counted. Jesus Christ does that. Riding in to die. Also, after living a perfectly sinless life. Now listen to this. Everybody else in Jerusalem had to have a little baby lamb to sacrifice that year because they all had sin. Jesus didn't have to have a lamb because he was the lamb. Jesus riding into town is the only lamb that will ever work to get rid of our sins. God gave us to him. He had to be pure just like those other little lambs. You know, I love watching the Iditarod sled race. Anybody know this Iditarod in Alaska where they go across Alaska? Think about this. Talk about self-sacrifice. They are commemorating another race. Back in 1926, this is the first time they ever did something like this, and now every year they have the Iditarod to commemorate this. 6-year-old Richard Stanley was in Nome, Alaska. He showed symptoms of diphtheria in 1926, and he passed away a day later. And the doctor, Dr. Welch, he began to realize we're in trouble. We got a diphtheria epidemic here in Nome. They had a brand new vaccine that they were going to try. But they ran out. So a group of trappers and prospectors volunteered to go 1,000 miles with their dog sled teams to get the medicine that the village of Nome needed. And it took them 144 hours in minus 50 degree winds, and they got the serum to Nome, Alaska. As a result of what they did, only one other person died of diphtheria in 1926. Hey, y'all, if people can do that for other people, think about what God can do for us. Riding into town. on that donkey. You know, it means God is adding the final and most important part of his salvation offer. Number two, I love this part. It means, number two, empty religious rituals will never again work between me and God. They were sacrificing hundreds of thousands of lambs. Why wasn't that good enough anymore? Because God was not happy with their sacrifice. You know, I was talking to Brother Jackie Blunt. Let me tell you about this. Think about how many religious rituals we all do. People all around the world, including us, that really don't mean anything. But I was talking to Brother Jackie Wednesday night. We were sitting at the dinner table in there, and I was telling him about when I went to Israel. Y'all listen to this. On the Sabbath, the Jews are still keeping the Old Testament law. Friday night at sundown to Saturday night at sundown is the Sabbath day. You cannot do anything. In fact, they go so far as, well, you got to eat on Saturday, right? So they go in their refrigerator before Friday night and unscrew the light bulb. Because if they open the refrigerator door to get some food and the light comes on, they've just sinned, according to what they believe. In other words, I've got to do this to keep from sinning. So I'm glad I don't have to unscrew the light bulb, aren't you? I can go in there at 3 o'clock in the morning on Saturday morning and look for the bacon, you know, whatever you want to eat. Other people, I remember getting to the hotel in Tel Aviv, Israel. This is because of this Old Testament law. We got to the hotel on a Saturday afternoon, the Sabbath day, and it was the Sabbath going on. So they made us sit in the hotel on our luggage for 3 hours till they would check us in. We've just flown from Atlanta to Tel Aviv, Israel, 14 hours nonstop, the red eye, and then you got to wait 3 more hours. What would you do if you went to Disney World and they made you wait 3 hours to check in to your hotel? Aren't you glad we don't have to do that stuff anymore? Because of Jesus, you know, we do all kind of things to appease God. You know, God, I'll come to Sunday school every Sunday. That'll make you happy, right? God, I'll join the choir. Or God, I'll go to seminary. God says, it doesn't do anything until your heart is in it. He says, if your heart is right, then all those things, if your heart is right with Jesus, then all those things make perfect sense. Let me bring it a little closer to home. We do a lot of rituals. These are kind of funny. This actually has been said to preachers in churches. Okay, I'm not making this up. This was on an article on the internet, a guy named Tom Rainier. This has been said. Talk about religious rituals. Listen to this. I don't believe, brother, preacher, that preachers who don't wear suits and ties aren't saved. It's in the Bible. Y'all show me the verse where it says I have to wear a coat and a tie. I like to wear it out of respect for the Lord. Here's what said another thing to a pastor. This is religious ritual. You shouldn't make people leave the youth group after they graduate. It's going to get really weird when the 70-year-olds are still in the youth group. We need to start attracting more normal people to this church, preacher. Anybody here normal? I'm sure not. Listen to this. This was actually said to a pastor. I developed cancer because you don't preach from the King James Version. A new carcinogen discovered. Brother pastor, not enough people signed up for the church golf tournament. You have poor leadership skills. And he says, his answer is, I'm so sorry, I expected more since most of the deacons play golf on Sunday morning. So that was his answer, not mine. If Jesus sang from the red hymnal, why can't we? And this is my favorite. Didn't you see me, preacher, waving from the back of the worship center? You preached too long. It was time to eat. Brothers and sisters, Jesus riding on that donkey into town means I don't have to do any more rituals to get to God. Isn't that a relief? Doesn't that free you up and free me up? I don't have to go through all this stuff. All I have to do is follow Jesus. It's so easy. It's so simple. We make it sometimes so difficult. Finally, number three this morning. When a lamb rides a donkey into town, it means my choice for where I spend eternity is simple and easy. You ever work somewhere and you were doing the job and you were always worried in the back of your mind they were going to come and fire you? Anybody besides me? I've worked at places when there was no security. You didn't know at any time they could come in. Some of the worst places I've ever worked were Christian ministries. And because they thought, okay, we've got God on our side, so we can just come in and fire you because God told us to. No, he didn't, because he would have told me to, you know. But so that's some of the worst places I've ever worked, because they weren't really walking with God. They were just running the ministry. You know, but you feel like at your job, you ever feel like you're the rat and they keep moving the cheese? Every time you get, come on, I'm not the only one now. You know, they're going to fire you anytime for nothing. You didn't do anything. You realize before Jesus, the people had to keep all these laws and regulations, 600 laws, all kind of rules. If you walked in the graveyard, you'd have to wash. I was watching a video the other day, and in the Jewish houses of Jesus' time, every house had a bathtub in it, just like a regular bathtub carved out of a rock, just like we have a bathtub. Then they had what it looked like a baptistry in their houses. You know what that was for in their day? If you did anything out of the ordinary that, according to the Old Testament, they had to keep that full of water, and you had to go get in there and wash yourself. Ritual washing. They called it a mikvah, and that's kind of where we get baptism from. Every house had one of these. The archaeologists have dug it up and everything. Do you realize when Jesus rode into town, all that is now gone? I don't have to do any of that stuff. I don't do any of that work. A new covenant. All I have to do is believe in and follow Jesus Christ. By the way, do you know what really happens in a church? Let me tell y'all. Everybody listen to me just for a second, and we're going to close. You know what really happens at the church when we're going to have the invitation in just a second? Let me make sure everybody understands. We're never asking you to join Southside Baptist because you like Southside Baptist. Do you realize we're never doing that? If you want to, that's great. We'd love to have you. We're never asking you to come and commit to Sunday school. We're not, when we give the invitation up here, we're never asking you to give your money to this church. Do you realize the only choice you're making when you come? Yes, Jesus. That's the only choice you ever have to make in your life. Yes, Jesus, I love you. And by the way, if you don't choose that, you're saying, no, Jesus, I don't. Isn't that so simple and easy? All that other stuff we do, you know, the singing in the choir and the coming to Sunday school, we only do that because we love Jesus. If you do that in your life, if you do the one thing, do what Jesus asks you to do, you will be the happiest person in the world. We make it so hard. We make it so difficult. Palm Sunday means we're free, brothers and sisters. He rode into town to take our place. By the way, heaven or hell is just the paycheck we get for choosing Jesus or rejecting Jesus. If we choose Jesus, we get heaven and forgiveness and all that. If we reject Jesus, we get hell. That's all you have to decide this morning. Anybody ever been to the airport and you had your ticket and you're waiting to fly besides me? You sit there for a couple hours, you know, you sit in those seats. Next time you ever go to the airport, y'all do this. Look at the difference between people who have their tickets and people who are on standby. Have you ever noticed this? The people who have their tickets already, they got a ticket to the plane. They're sitting around, they're reading the newspaper, they're relaxing, they got their feet propped up. You want to look at the people who are on standby, trying to get on the flight. What are they doing? They're pacing back and forth. They're pacing. They're up there at the counter. They're talking to them. Got any seats yet? You know, they can't relax because they don't know if they're on the plane or not. I need to get my flight. I need to get home. Let me ask you a question as we close. What if in 15 minutes from right now, we were all standing before Jesus Christ? What if the rapture happened at 12:15 and we're all standing? Would you be pacing or would you be relaxed? That's really the only question. That's what Palm Sunday means. Jesus Christ rode into town on that donkey. A lamb rode in on the donkey to take our place and to die for our sins so that we can live and die. Incredible. A lamb riding into town on a donkey says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Let's pray together. Father, we love you this morning. Thank you so much for this wonderful service. Father, Palm Sunday is a day we celebrate what you did. Thank you for riding into town. Thank you for dying on that cross. Thank you that we can live and live eternally because of your death. Father, have your will in your way. I pray if there's someone here today who's not sure of where they're going to spend eternity. All they got to do is say, yes, Jesus, I want you. That's it. Everything else you'll take care of. All we're doing when we have this invitation is saying yes to Jesus. Or if we don't come and we know we need to come, we're saying no, Jesus. And we'll have to live with the consequences of that decision. Father, I pray, give us the wisdom, all of us, no matter where we are, to say yes to Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to stand and sing a hymn of invitation. And I don't have that. You might. Please come. All right, please come. And as we sing, the altar is open. Whatever decision you want to make, you can say yes to Jesus Christ this morning. That's what church is all about. Let's come as we stand and sing. I'm going to ask Miss Gay to play a little bit, and we're going to sing one more verse, and we're going to close. Brothers and sisters, this is it. All you're doing, and I'm begging you, everybody, I don't know where you are with Jesus. I do not know. Nobody knows except each of us ourselves. This is your chance on Palm Sunday, one more verse, to say, yes, Jesus, I want to follow you. Wherever you are, he'll take you, and he'll make you who you really want to be. Let's sing one more verse. Guys look so beautiful this morning. It's so good to see everybody. We're going to close in just a second. Let me remind everybody, we have church conference tonight at 6 o'clock. It is very important that if you can come. We're making a lot of decisions about some very important things in the church. And you know, now listen, everybody, I want to make sure everybody understands, this church is governed by the members of this church, not the pastor, not the deacons, not the church council. The members vote, and that's what we do. So if you're not here, you can't vote. And whatever we vote, we're going to do. Right? Does everybody understand? So 6 o'clock tonight, please come. This is your church, not mine. I don't vote. So please come and cast your vote. We want to hear your opinion. We want your input in the business of this church. Very important. Okay. Any other announcements before we close? What's that? The Armor of God Ladies Bible Study at 4 o'clock. 5 o'clock is deacons meetings. Okay, wait. 4 o'clock is deacons meeting. I'm Church council at 5. I'm on the old time still. Any other announcements? Yes, sir. How old do you have to be before you get cut out of the children's Easter egg hunt? All right. Y'all hear that? We can hunt with the kids Wednesday night. I want to, somebody hide me a golden one out there with some new corneas in it, okay, will you? All right, anything else? Thank you, musicians, everybody, such singers. That was such a blessing of a service. Bless y'all so much, and it's good to see everybody. I'm going to ask Brother Sean Smith if he closes in prayer.
Lord, we humbly thank you for allowing us to worship you today, and we thank you for blessing this church with all the love that is inside these doors, Lord, and we ask that you give us the strength to carry that love out into the community each day. All this we ask in your precious name. Amen.